still going to see the doctor and determine where they're going from there. Remember the old days. This coming Tuesday evening is our Shrove Tuesday pancake meal. Hopefully you'll be able to come to that Tuesday evening. On Wednesday evening, beginning of Lent with Ash Wednesday, and hopefully we'll see you there at that service at 7:30 p.m. with Ashes and Holy Communion. Over to my left, to your right, is some bake sale items to help fund the our catechism kids going to the retreat at Camp Moana coming up in March. So please go over there and peruse the items. You can smell them as you sit there. Go over and peruse them. Buy a couple things. If you want to just contribute some money and buy something and give it to me, that's fine too. I'm going to be headed out, or I guess you don't even know that. Well, I'm going to Sandusky to see my mom. My mom's celebrating her 89th birthday Tuesday, so we're going up there to celebrate. But I'll be here for the whole service for you guys. That was supposed to be for the second service, so never mind. And we have our Gideon speaker is here with us this morning. His name is Mr. David Klein, and he would like to talk to you for a couple of minutes. Mr. Klein, it's good to have you with us. Welcome, and his lovely wife is here with us as well. Good to have you both. Make yourselves at home.
There is no God. You see, that's what David thought, because the closest he had ever came to a Bible was the one that laid in his grandmother's living room, and he wasn't even allowed to be in there. David dropped out of school and soon found himself in trouble with the law and was arrested and convicted. Sent to prison, and when he got there, he wasn't even a very good prisoner either, and found himself in solitary confinement. David had really given up on life. His thoughts were on suicide. He looked at all kinds of religions and found no help. So he decided that he would just starve himself to death. Figured that was the best way out. So as the guards would come down the hall and open that little window and slide his tray in, he would bend down and take his hand and knock the tray back out, spilling the contents on the guard. And that went on a few days, and he heard them footsteps coming down the hallway, so he got down ready to knock the tray out. They stuck a little book in there, and he grabbed the book and throwed it behind him and got ready. And then he heard the footsteps walking away. So he went over and he picked the book up and he sat down and he started reading it. And he read about the first of Genesis, about the creation. And then he went to Matthew and read about the Christmas story. And his statement was, why hadn't anybody ever told me about this before? Within just a short period of time, he received Christ as his Savior. He now pastors a church. His name is Reverend David Graham. He pastors a church in North Florida. You see, we have a promise in God's Word that as the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return to it without watering the earth and making it flourish so that it yields seed for the sower and bread for the eater, so is my word that goes forth out of my mouth, that it shall not return to me empty, but accomplish that which I achieved the purpose for which I sent it. The Gideons are made up of Christian business and professional men whose sole purpose is to win men, women, and boys and girls to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. We do this by placing scriptures in the pathways of life, such as hotel, nursing home, doctor's office, college students, military, police, firefighters, EMS, prisoners, airplanes, trains, and in local schools, fifth grade and up. Gideons are in 194 countries in the world, and we have over 94 translations of the scripture. And last year, we handed out 84 million scriptures, actually over 84 million scriptures. And that's one big number, and that's awful hard to get your hand on. But you can feel your heart. Every time your heart beats, two scriptures not a bad boy, but he was kind of into smoking and telling small lies. But when Philip got his little testimony, he read it, and in a very short time received Christ as his Savior. But see, the story don't end there, because Philip sat down with three of his friends and led them to the Lord also. At least that was the letter that he sent us, and that's been a few years ago, so who knows how many he's led to the Lord now. Every one of these little scriptures that we have, the average cost is around $1.30. I would say that was a real good investment for $1.30. Philip, three of his friends, four people, $1.30. Wouldn't you? You say, well, how could I help? Number one thing that Gideon's need is prayer. Pray that the doors would stay open to all the places in the world that we are allowed to hand scriptures out. And even in this country, because we've been attacked here, first by schools moving off the main highway so that we have no way to get to them, and handing out to our military. One third of all the scriptures is handed out in the world outside the United States. One third of all those scriptures are paid for by little congregations just like you all over this United States. One other way that you can help is simply by using the Gideon card. I looked at your little display out front. It's full of cards, very easy to do. And if you haven't looked at those cards, if you look on the back of every one of them, there is a testimony back here of how somebody can receive Christ by reading the Bible that this card provided. You know, the stats say that there's over 7 billion people in the world. 4 billion of them have never even heard about the good news of the Lord Jesus Christ. What would be your part?
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you for being with us. We have free will offering for the Gideons. There are plates at both entrance and exits at the church. Plenty of places to leave your money this morning. Looking for places to do that. Will you please rise? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who creates us and forms us, who redeems us and calls us, who unites us and sends us. Gathered in God's presence, let us confess our sin. Mighty and loving God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We seek our own way. We rely on the body of Christ. In your mercy, cleanse us. Hear the voice.
The first reading is from the 34th chapter of Exodus. Moses came down from Mount Sinai. As he came down from the mountain with the two tablets of the covenant in his hand, Moses did not know that the skin of his face shone because he had been talking with God. When Aaron and all the Israelites saw Moses, the skin of his face was shining, and they were afraid to come near him. But Moses called to them, and Aaron and all the leaders of the congregation returned to him. And Moses spoke with them. Afterward, all the Israelites came near, and he gave them in commandment all that the Lord had spoken with him on Mount Sinai. When Moses had finished speaking with them, he put a veil on his face. But whenever Moses went in before the Lord to speak with him, he would take the veil off until he came out. And when he came out and told the Israelites what he had been commanded, the Israelites would see the face of Moses, that the skin of his face was shining, and Moses would put the veil on his face again until he went in to speak with him. The word of the Lord. Now we will read Psalm 99, responsibly by whole verse. The Lord is king, let the people tremble. He is enthroned upon the cherubim, let the earth shake.
The Lord is great in Zion, he is high above all peoples.
Let them confess his name, which is great and awesome. He is the Holy One. Proclaim the greatness of the Lord our God and fall down before his footstool. He is the Holy One. He spoke to them out of the pillar of cloud. They kept his testimonies and the decree that he gave them. Proclaim the greatness of the Lord our God and worship him upon his holy hill. For the Lord our God is the Holy One. The second reading is from 2 Corinthians. Since then, we have such a hope, we act with great boldness, not like Moses, who put a veil over his face to keep the people of Israel from gazing at the end of the glory that was being set aside. But their minds were hardened. Indeed, to this very day, when they hear the reading of the Old Covenant, the same veil is still there. Since only in Christ is it set aside. Indeed, to this very day, whenever Moses is read, a veil lies over their minds. But when one turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And all of us, with unveiled faces, seeing the glory of the Lord as though reflected in a mirror, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, the Spirit. Therefore, since it is by God's mercy that we are engaged in this ministry, we do not lose heart. We have renounced the shameful things that one hides. We refuse to practice cunning or to falsify God's word. But by the open statement of the truth, we commend ourselves to the conscience of everyone in the sight of God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
dazzling white. Suddenly they saw two men, Moses and Elijah, talking to him. They appeared in glory and were speaking of his departure, which was about to be accomplished in Jerusalem. Now Peter and his companions were weighed down with sleep, but since they had stayed awake, they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. Just as they were leaving him, Peter said to Jesus, "Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah," not knowing what he said. While he was saying this, a cloud came and overshadowed them. They were terrified as they entered the cloud. Then from the cloud came a voice that said, "This is my son, my chosen. Listen to him." When the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone. They kept silent, and in those days told no one any of the things they had seen. On the next day, when they had come down from the mountain, a great crowd met them. Just then a man from the crowd shouted, "Teacher, I beg you to look at my son. He is my only child." Suddenly a spirit seizes him, and all at once he shrieks. It convulses him until he foams at the mouth. It mauls him and will scarcely leave him alone. "I beg your disciples to cast it out," but they could not. Jesus answered, "You faithless and perverse generation, how much longer must I be with you and bear with you? Bring your son here." While he was coming, the demon dashed him to the ground in convulsions. But Jesus rebuked the unclean spirit, healed the boy, gave him back to his father, and all were astounded at the greatness of God. The Gospel of our Lord. Could you sort of understand some things I was doing, though? I was singing. Could you tell that a little bit? I know it's hard for me to tell when I'm singing anyway. Could you tell when I was singing a little bit? Yeah. Could you tell when I was trying to tell a joke? Trying to be funny? Well, some people got it, but not everyone. You could sort of tell, but really couldn't tell too much of what I was saying at all. You know what? Today's gospel lesson says the disciples really didn't understand Jesus so much. They didn't understand what he was all about. Sometimes they got it, sometimes they didn't. And it's so hard to understand everything all the time. Do you think is there anyone that understands everything all the time? You know what? I don't think any of us really understands the love of God all the time. God's love is so big, so strong, it's everywhere, and it's so difficult to understand all the time that it's always with us. We just need to remember that no matter what, the love of Jesus is there. All the time. Even if we don't understand how it is, where it is, his love is always here with us and always will be. And that's way cool, isn't it? Okay. Blessing that one. See you next week. Make sure you get children's bulletin. morning's gospel is just one more time, among so many other times, when the disciples sort of give it and sort of don't. Like most things maybe in life for all of us. Sometimes sort of give it, sort of don't. They have what they call the broken heart syndrome. Broken heart syndrome is actually very true. It is real. After major emotional stress or after major physical trauma, after losing a loved one, for instance, the body produces less white corpuscles and stress hormones are released that overwhelm the heart at times. The heart can enlarge. It doesn't pump very well. Much of the left ventricle freezes. So quite literally, hearts can break. Our hearts can't. I've often wondered whether the greatest pain that Jesus ever knew in his whole life was when he was on the cross, and I'm not talking about physical pain. I mean, was his heart breaking? From a standpoint of wondering, is this going to mean anything to them? What are they going to do with this? What will they do with the sacrifice? Was his heart breaking? Worried about whatever will happen. I think Christians should be the most optimistic people in the world. I say that here and there. They really should be the most optimistic people in the world. Because we understand that our pasts are forgiven. Whatever happened back there has been forgiven. We have a comfort in the present, encouraged in the present, that Christ, in fact, will be with us, the strongest force on the earth and in heaven itself. And we have the promise of the future. The future is absolutely guaranteed. So therefore, Christians should be the most optimistic people on the face of the earth. And yet, quite often, we're the exact opposite. Including myself, at times. Yeah. I go through this little test of mine every once in a while. I try to decide whether or not I'm an optimist or a pessimist. You ever do that? I'm not really too sure which one I am, to be honest with you. Being totally honest. I don't expect very much from people. I guess that kind of makes me a pessimist. And yet I think they often surprise me with their love, with their kindness, with their grace. So maybe that makes me an optimist. I don't think that people understand the love of Jesus Christ very well. And yet I think that they try to share it. People intentionally hurt one another. But yet I don't think they really realize what that hurt causes, the pain it causes. Forgiving is difficult. And not forgiving is even more difficult. Some people make it very, very difficult to love them. On the pessimistic side. But you can love them. It's on the optimistic side. If you try. They just take more work, some people. I don't believe that anyone has their act together. And that I think we can all change the world in a very positive way. And we can let Jesus Christ change us. I think we are all hypocritical. And yet I think that people can be right here and there. And I think that they do mean well. So I don't know. I'm an optimist or a pessimist. Maybe I'm a little bit of both. I don't know about you. I do know if being a Christian is easy for you, as I say and as I tell the confirmation classes, if being a Christian is easy for you, you're not doing it right. I do know that. Because this is difficult stuff. Very, very difficult stuff. And if you think it's simple, it's easy, blinding. That's what happens to the disciples on this mountain. It blinds them, the truth. They know that something cool is there. It's like a moth to a light. But they don't know exactly what to do with it. And as I say, people have to be taught how to love. Wanting to love comes naturally. The desire to be loved is natural. The desire to share love is natural. But we don't know what to do with it, and we have to be taught what to do with it. We have to be taught how to trust it. There was a man who could count on his son to help him out whenever he needed help. If he needed a snow shovel, his son would be there. All he had to do was call him. If he needed help trying to figure out his cell phone, he'd call his son. His son would help him. Getting things down from the attic, he'd just call his son. His son would help him. One day, he texted his son. Guy learned how to do that. He texted his son this message: "Windows frozen, won't open." His son texted back: "Gently pour lukewarm water." A few minutes later, the father texted back: "Now the computer is really messed up." Sometimes, even when we try to help, we don't really know what the problem is. Don't really know how to help. And we get it goofed up. We don't know what we're seeing. Like Peter and James and John, we don't really, truly know what we're seeing. Jesus can not be just added to our confusion in our life. And then we can expect everything to be fine and hunky-dory. We have to start first with Jesus. And then the confusion, in fact, will all be sorted out. We can be a fickle group of people, though. Our way or the highway, that's the way we normally operate. And sometimes we know we're being contradictory. Other times we don't. We do know sometimes. There's a great little song by a guy named John Frying. In the song, part of the lyrics goes, "Father, forgive us for what we must do, even before we do it." So we know we're going to be contradictory sometimes. Mark Twain said, "Quitting smoking is not difficult at all." He said, "I've done it several times." And on and on, we keep on trying, struggling. Slave owners were kind of very interesting in their justifications for being able to own slaves. I don't know how much you've studied about the slave trade and slavery. It's really a fascinating kind of thing in many different ways. One thing, of course, most slave owners believed they were doing their slaves a favor by having them as slaves, so they didn't have to stay in Africa. They could instead be here in this country, where they had it much better, they convinced themselves. Slave owners in the Caribbean had a rather interesting tradition that if a slave master was going to have an affair with one of his slaves, and we didn't really call it an affair, that's kind of a wrong term to use, should use much harsher word than that. But if a slave owner was going to have relations with one of his slaves, what he did first was that he baptized the woman. He baptized her first to make her a Christian. He couldn't have this relationship with someone who wasn't a Christian. He thought he was doing the will of God. Can you imagine? There's a guy who was going to have only one shoe on, and someone told him, he said, "Hey, you lost a shoe." He said, "No, I found one." We're on our way. It does not take complete understanding to love completely. Peter and James and John did not have complete understanding. And yet they could still love completely. You and I do not have complete understanding of this world, and yet we can still trust in that love that completes us. We can trust in it completely, even though we don't understand a whole lot of other stuff. This guy walked into a pet store. He saw a parrot that was on a little perch. And this parrot had a red string on one foot, had a blue string on the other foot. And they asked the pet store owner. He said, "What's up with that parrot with those strings?" And the pet store owner said, "Hey, that's a very intelligent, highly trained parrot." He said, "All you have to do is pull that red string, and he'll talk in French. Go ahead and pull it." So the guy went over and pulled the string, untied it. He said, "Wow, that's amazing." He said, "Yeah, okay, now tie it back up." And the guy did. He said, "Now untie the blue one." He untied the blue one. The bird started speaking in French, or in English, in Spanish, excuse me. So he started speaking in Spanish. The guy said, "That's absolutely amazing." And the guy said, "Yeah, now tie it back up." So he did. The guy said, "Well, what happens if I pull them both at the same time?" Which he did. And the parrot shouted out, "I fall off." Can't be for something and against something at the same time. We have to have something holding on to us somewhere. Abraham Lincoln said during the Civil War, it was one of my favorite Lincoln lines, which I like to repeat here and there. Lincoln said, someone came up to him and said, "Mr. President, let's hope that God is on our side in this war." And Lincoln said, "Let's pray that we are on the side of God." God can't be for and against something at the same time. There was a woman at an airport. This man was kind of watching her. People watching. Everybody liked to people watch. He was people watching this woman at the airport. She was saying goodbye to a couple of her family members. She saw him hug each and every one of them and tell them that she loved them. And then with each one, she would just say, "I wish you enough." Curiosity got the better of them, and finally, after they all left and they were sitting there together, getting ready to board the plane, he asked her, he said, "What was up with that? That I love you, I wish you enough." And she said that it was handed down to her from previous generations. She said, "My parents used to say it to everyone." She said, "The other person should have enough good things to sustain them. I wish you enough sun to keep your attitude bright. I wish you enough rain for you to appreciate the sun. I wish you enough happiness to keep your spirit alive. I wish you enough joy so that the burdens and pains in life are easier to bear. I wish you enough gain to satisfy your needs and to help others in their needs. I wish you enough loss to help you appreciate what you possess. I wish you enough hellos to get you through the goodbyes." Pessimist, optimist, I'm not really too sure at times. I don't expect the world to be a fine, hunky-dory place today. Anybody else expect that? Things are going to happen. Some terrible things are going to happen. So are some good things. And the love of Jesus Christ is over it all, embraces it all. I sure believe in the power of sin, and I sure believe in the power of evil. But I believe more in the power of God's grace. I believe more in the power of His love that can overcome all that evil, and it can sustain each of us. I'm not a believer in God's plans very much. I know. I think God does have a plan. I think His plan is for us to love Him and one another. But other than that, I'm not a strong believer that everyone has an individual plan in their life, as some of you know. And if you do, that's perfectly fine. I'm just not a believer in that. I think what God's plan is basically He says, do something. Do anything. Pray for someone. Send them a letter. Send them a card. Just be kind. Be generous. Are you going to be a baker? That's great. Just be a decent baker. Try to help out as much as you can. Try to show the love of God in whatever you do. A police officer, a housewife, a teacher, whatever it happens to be. Just do something. Be generous with your forgiveness. kindness with your words. And know that even in the confusion of life, and whatever we feel, whatever we see, whatever we understand, whatever we do not understand, regardless of where we have been, where we are, and where we're going, that His love is there with us. It is good to be here. Peter, John, and James, Savior Jesus. It is good that Jesus is always here with us all. Amen. Thank you. Heal the sick, comfort the grieving, send peace to the dying, and companionship to those in prison. Whether the prison is one for correction or one built of human loneliness, be with all who suffer in any kind of way, including Kathleen Ward and Valerie, Esther Denny, Jackie and Dustin Brown, Anna Wong, Alex Overhouse, Lucas Rosebrook, Joshua Jenny, Ken Ludeman, Linda, Roma Brown, Paul Long, Larry Zachary, Mary Brown, Paul Kuzno, Jeff Warner, Rudy Eichhoff, Walter Thompson, Pat Bainhoff, Alfred and Rita Prigge and Marjorie Downs, Pete Miller, Brent Leiter, Alexa Jennings and Paul Panning, Emma Myers, Andrew Williams, C.A., Miranda Shane, Leora Pedraza, Jeff Kiefer, Herman Campbell and Ben Thompson, Rudy and Ann Raby, Kelly Garst, Naomi Rhodes, George and Cindy Pope and Jamie Bossom, Arlena Panning, Kelly Troyer, Linda Hill and Bethany Wolf, Colleen Cable, Lois Wieners, Alan Carlisle, J.P., Derek Morian, Don and Susan Dravis, Alice Langenhoff, Ted Tittgemeier, Kate Michaelis and Crystal Garcia, Borna Bossaman, Josh Badenhoff, Sandy Bossaman, Louisa Bell, Shirley Myers-Fages and KT, Betsy Mix, Joe, Norma Ehlers and Ellen Lang, Charlotte Longren, Melanie Simpson, Eleanor Engler, Jeannie Curtis, Roman Strome, Larry Jenman, Fred Close, Bill Winsman, Pauline Downer, Robert Plaston, Josh Bell, Norma Strayer, Linda Lals, Amy Rodenball, David and Betty Meyer, Sandra Homer, Marlene Pryor, Brennan, Jeff Brown, Tammy Porter, and Allie Grace Small, Ruth M. Eichhoff, Carol Berlin, Lucas King, Dick Brown, Sarah Lenhart, and Deb Shank, Landon Zunk, John and Dorothy Harms, and all those we name now in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy, we pray, Heavenly Father, for all those in our congregational family who will be celebrating their birthdays in this coming week. Those people include Lindley Diem, Jared Jenkins, Derek Morin, Carmen Brook, Susan Schenk, Phyllis Winner, Laura Speaks, Arlene Miller, Daniel Campbell, Brett Mason, Nicholas Mason, John Moeller, Ethan Plummer, Kurt Roars, Lindsay Stewart. We pray on your anniversary for Daryl and Laura Lee Jones. We also pray, Heavenly Father, for all those serving in military service from this our congregation and this our country, including Mike Demache, Elizabeth Yoder, Tyler Hayes, and Austin Over. Into your loving hands, gracious God, we place ourselves and all of our prayers, spoken and unspoken, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, forever and ever. Amen.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace.